My name is Minister Barton Aaron Porter, and today we're going to go into our Father's Word for another exciting Bible study. Now, I'm going to be using the good old King James Version of the Holy Bible, as I always do. So I encourage you to get your Bibles out and to study along with me. Let's approach our Heavenly Father's throne with a word of prayer before we get into this video. Father God, in the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior, we come with bowed heads and humble hearts, confessing our many sins, Lord, asking that you forgive us, wash us in the blood of Jesus Christ, the Lamb of God, the Savior of the world. We put all our hope and trust in that precious blood he shed for us at Calvary, Lord. And we ask right now, Almighty God, that you fill us with your precious Holy Spirit as we go into your word, the Holy Bible. In the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior, we thank you, Almighty God, for hearing our prayer. Amen. The title of today's Bible study is Persecution and the Gospel. Today, we're going to talk about persecution and the gospel because they go together like a hand in a glove. Now, persecution is the pressure that comes upon a Christian as he or she does the work of God in this wicked world. Satan, the devil, will constantly move his people against the people of God to try to discourage and take out the saints. That's what he does. The gospel is the good news that God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son that whosoever believeth on him should not perish but have everlasting life. And that is the job of every born-again believer. We're supposed to be heralding that message. And so because I'm doing my part for God, I'm constantly bombarded with difficulty. And that's just part of it. See, it's very important that you understand when you were born into this fallen world, you were born into a life of hardship. Whether you're a Christian or not, you're going to have to deal with difficulties. That's why in Job chapter 14, verse 1, the Holy Bible says, man that is born of a woman is a few days and full of trouble. That means you're going to deal with difficulties your entire life. And when it says man, it means mankind. So that's just part of it. But the suffering that a Christian experiences is different. We're suffering for righteousness' sake. We're suffering because we are soldiers of Jehovah in the army of God. We're suffering because we serve our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, and the devil's trying to take us out. That's why in 2 Timothy chapter 3, verse 12, the Apostle Paul, being guided by the Spirit of God, wrote, yea, which means yes. Yes, and all that will live godly in Christ Jesus shall suffer persecution. So I've been suffering for Christ for many years, and I've gotten to the point where it doesn't bother me as much as it used to. And that's why I'm doing this Bible study video, hoping that the Lord will guide some person who's not handling the suffering to see what the scriptures say about suffering for Christ and the help that they can get by calling out to God. See, you and I can't do anything without God. There are some people who think they can, but you can't. And so Psalms 55 verse 22 says, cast thy burden upon the Lord. Cast your problems upon the Lord, whatever it is. And he will sustain thee, and he will sustain you. He shall never suffer the righteous to be moved. That's a promise from Almighty God. That's why when the devil moves his people to bring difficulty to me, fire me or whatever, accusations, whatever, I don't get all bent out of shape. Now, I'm not going to sit here and say it doesn't bother me at all, because it does. I'm a human being. But I know at this point in my walk with God that I need to give it to God and let him handle it. Because if I do it, it's not going to be done God's way. Some people get sad when people do bad things to them. I get mad and I want to get even. But being a mature Christian, I know what the Bible says about trying to get revenge. The Bible says that vengeance belongs to God. So I know that. So I have to pray to God to help me change the way I'm thinking, not to be angry, not to try to get even. If the people who are doing these bad things to me got something coming, the Lord's going to give it to them. He'll take care of it. And so that's why Jesus said in Matthew chapter 5, verse 43 to 45, He says, ye have heard that it has been said, thou shalt love thy neighbor and hate thine enemy. I'm going to translate this in modern day English. Jesus said, you have heard that it has been said, you will love your neighbor and hate your enemy. Verse 44. He says, but I say unto you, love your enemies, bless them that curse you, do good to them that hate you, and pray for them which despitefully use you and persecute you. So this is what God wants us to do instead of getting mad and trying to get even. This is what the Lord says, and he tells us why. Verse 45, that ye, or that you, may be the children of your Father which is in heaven, for he maketh, or he makes his sun to rise on the evil and on the good, and sendeth rain, or sends rain, on the just and the unjust. So God is showing mercy to the wicked every single day. And the Lord wants us to show mercy to the wicked too. When they were killing Jesus, when they were nailing him to the cross, he prayed for the people nailing him to the cross. He said, Lord, forgive them, for they know not what they do. And I'm hoping that me sharing this with you saints will help somebody out there be encouraged that these are the type of things that happen when you're going to live a life for God. And it shouldn't get you all riled up, because the Lord says in 1 Peter chapter 4, verse 12, he says, beloved, think it not strange concerning the fiery trial which is to try you, as though some strange thing happened unto you or happened to you. In other words, this is part of being a Christian. You know, all that will live godly in Christ Jesus will suffer persecution. He says in verse 13, 1 Peter chapter 4, but rejoice inasmuch as ye, or you, are partakers of Christ's sufferings, that when his glory shall be revealed, ye, or you, may be glad also with exceeding joy. So if we suffer with the Lord, we're going to reign with him. So that's why when you're suffering for righteousness' sake, you should rejoice that the Lord has counted you worthy to suffer for him. 1 Peter chapter 4, verse 14, he says, if ye be reproached, or if you be disgraced for the name of Christ, happy are ye, or you should be happy that you're being disgraced for the name of Christ. For the Spirit of glory and of God rests upon you. And on their part he is evil spoken of, but on your part he is glorified. 15. Listen, but let none of you suffer as a murderer, as a thief, or as a evildoer, or as a busybody in other men's matters. That's 15. Verse 16 says, yet if any man, and it always means women too, any man or woman suffer as a Christian, let him or her not be ashamed, but let him or her glorify God on this behalf. And that is my attitude, saints, the attitude of gratitude. And I'm going to pray for them, because the Lord says he wants us to pray for the lost, all the enemies of the cross, because they know not what they do. They're condemning their own souls to hell when they attack the people of God. And that's our stance. That's what God wants us to understand, and to allow him to handle the problem. See, the Lord says our attitude should be this when we suffer for righteousness' sake. James chapter 1, verse 2, it says, my brethren, which means brothers and sisters in Christ, my brothers and sisters in Christ, count it all joy when ye, or when you, fall into divers, that means various, temptations. Verse 3, knowing this, that the trying of your faith worketh patience, or works patience. So he says, count it all joy when all these temptations are brought to you, and know that God is allowing your faith to be tried so patience can be developed in you. See, God even uses the suffering that he allows to shape our character and mold us and make us better Christians. See, I happen to know through the Holy Spirit and through the Word of God that this suffering that we're experiencing is not only part of being a Christian, but it's preparing us for the final test when the Antichrist is going to appear on this stage. And it's going to be open season on all true Christians at that time. So if you and I don't learn how to rely on God now when we're suffering this light affliction, we're not going to make it when Antichrist shows up if we're still here. Jesus said in Matthew chapter 10, verse 22, and ye, speaking to his followers, and you shall or will be hated of all men for my name's sake. But he or she that endures to the end shall or will be saved. So I know why I'm hated by the wicked and the lost. They hate me because they ain't me. Their hearts are full of jealousy and envy because they are lost and they don't even know what they're on this planet for. They think they're here to obtain money and things, which is something that could never bring them true joy or happiness, and it's something that they can't keep. And so I totally understand that, and that's why we should pray for them, because they're lost and they're nowhere near to being found. I go to my job every morning, 5 days a week, and do it to the best of my ability with a big smile on my face and joy in my heart, being friendly and kind to all people, because that's the evidence of the Holy Ghost living inside of me. And because of just being a good, happy Christian, hated by a lot of people around there, people whispering things and lying and accusing and all kinds of evil things. Well, that's how it is for true Christians. So you better get used to it. Jesus said in Luke 9:23, he says, if any man or woman, I was at the woman, any man or woman will come after me or become a disciple and start living for him. This is what he's talking about. Let him or her deny himself or herself and take up his or her cross daily and follow me. So he said, just like they persecuted me, they're going to do it to you. So that's part of being a Christian. But the Lord has made us a promise in Hebrews chapter 13, verse 5 and 6. The apostle, being guided by the Spirit of God, wrote these words. He says, let your conversation be without covetousness. Now, conversation here is not like me talking to you right now. This word, when you look up in the Strong's, it should have been translated behavior. Let your behavior be without covetousness. Covetousness is when you want something that belongs to someone else instead of asking God to bless you with your own. So let your behavior be without covetousness, and be content with such things as ye or as you have. So God says, be content with what I gave you. See, I don't want anything that belongs to no one else. There are people who are wealthy. They got money and big houses and mansions and cars. I could care less. I don't want none of that stuff anyway. I'm grateful for having a roof over my head. I'm grateful for the food that I eat every day. I'm grateful for my little beautiful wife that the Lord gave me. She's the second best thing he's ever done for me. The first thing was Jesus Christ dying for my sins and making it possible for me to be saved into his eternal kingdom. And I'm just grateful for these things. So I'm content with what I have, all right? But he says, for he has said, God has said this. This is a promise now. I will never leave thee nor forsake thee. God says, I will never leave you or forsake you. That's why I'm not worried, knowing that my Father will continuously provide for me like he has done all my life. He's been providing for me even before I became a Christian. If this particular Bible study has been a blessing to you and you want to bless me with a love gift for any amount, this is how you can do that. Go to paypal.com, download the PayPal app. It's free. And if you choose to do it that way, then you would use this code to send me your love gift. PayPal.me/BartonPorter. You can also download the free Cash App, which is the one I prefer. My code is cash.app/$1014. And then there are people who prefer Zelle. For Zelle, all you need is my name, Barton Porter, and my phone number, which is 630-441-4563. And then some people prefer to give their money through Patreon. Patreon.com/Barton_Porter. Now, here are non-financial ways you can be a blessing to yours truly and this ministry. I need your prayers, saints. Pray for Minister Porter and pray for this ministry. And share the Bible study videos. If you're being blessed or encouraged or taught through this ministry, share these Bible study videos with as many people as possible. And if you have any Bible questions or prayer requests, you can call me at 630-441-4563. I live in Illinois, so I'm in the Central Time Zone. Be reasonable about the times you call. Just don't call me late at night. And if you don't have a phone, you can email me your Bible questions or prayer requests or whatever you want to send me. Send it to BartonAaronPorter@gmail.com. Now, these last few things are of the utmost importance, saints. I need you to subscribe to my YouTube channel. Take the time to hit the subscribe button. It does not cost you a penny. And underneath the video also, after you hit the subscription button, there's a little bell icon. Click on that bell icon. That bell is the notification icon. I release Bible study videos every Monday, Wednesday, and Friday. Every time a video is released, you will get a notification. It will let you know a new video is available. And underneath the video, there's two thumbs, one up, one down. If you like my video, if you like the content, please take the time to hit that thumbs up button. And last but not least, if you really were blessed by a Bible study video, take the time to put something in the comment section.